154 years ago, a journey was begun from India to Trinidad and Tobago that has had significant repercussions on the Indian diaspora. A journey that was to tell a remarkable story of endurance, strength of purpose, and survival. It is the story of Yatra, the journey of the Indian presence in Trinidad and Tobago. I'm Anita Chandradath Singh, welcoming you to journey with me on Yatra. You're about to see a compilation of the 25-part documentary series that I created in 1995 for the 150th anniversary of Indian arrival for TV6. It is dedicated to the forefathers and mothers who sacrificed and toiled to build this nation. The story of the Yatra from India to the West Indies is a fascinating one. Circumstances in India and the expediency of the colonial office in Britain contributed to this mass exodus. The poor peasant worker was in distress. The stringent system of taxation and loyalty to greedy landlords cheated the poor peasant. Should he leave his home and all that is dear and venture into the crowded city? This was a time of drought, crop failure, famine. In the United Provinces, there was a steady internal immigration of peasants from rural areas to the urban centers such as Lucknow and Kanpur. In this vulnerable state, sometimes by choice, sometimes by coercion, bewildered peasants found themselves forced to sign up as contracted laborers to be dispatched to the Trinidad Immigration Agency in Calcutta. The farmers and laborers from Chota Nagpur were especially favored for work in the sugarcane plantations of the colonies, as they were hardworking, docile, and able to cope with severe hardships. In the harbor of Calcutta, the ship's sails are set. Hundreds of men, women, and children are about to embark upon an unknown journey across the Kalapani, the black waters of uncertainty. Some ships stopped off at the port of Madras to make up the numbers for a shortfall of indentured workers from the north. Onward ho to the West Indies. The journey was long and perilous, passing through various climatic zones. The 3 months at sea tested the endurance of the immigrants. Thrown together, huddled in cramped conditions, they were forced to lean upon each other for emotional and spiritual support. The divide, so apparent in the motherland, of the caste system and untouchability began to fall away. The language barriers were also broken, as communication became a need. Right there on the ship, a whole new Indian person began to emerge. There was tolerance and the will to survive. Thus was born the Jahaji family, whose links would be cherished long after. You can imagine the jubilation aboard the Fateh al-Razak at the first sight of land. There in the misty distance lay Chiniadeep, or Sugar Island, Trinidad. As the ship came into harbor, she encircled the island just short of the mainland. Nelson Island, or Panyadeep, where those who had been unwell could convalesce and others could be screened for malaria or tuberculosis during a few weeks of quarantine. The tired and worn shipload of indentured immigrants must have experienced mixed feelings as they came toward the jetty. The mixture of relief, some excitement, and some trepidation. It was a significant moment in history when the first forefathers stepped off the ship and paid his respects to Dharti Mata, the same Mother Earth that is mother in India or here or anywhere else. This step was to herald a new dawning. The Indian diaspora had touched Trinidad. Remembering this moment, Raviji had once written, "Come, walk with me and see my majesty and grace, and let my leaves enrich the soil with my being." They brought their cherished seeds and plants, the sacred tulsi, the jamun, the mango, and so much more. But where would they plant? The soil was so hard in the tropical sun. The only water was stored in large cauldrons, and that was only for drinking. He was told that the mainland of Trinidad had rich, fertile soil, so he attended to his plants in the meanwhile, while the staff at the depot attended to him and his fellow Jahajis as they recuperated. Weary, he carried his janji bundle up the steps, wondering what lay ahead. He remembered his family, his home, far back in Bharat Desh. He looked across the empty ocean. He had crossed the Kalapani. They shared a large room, just as on the ship, but now they could move more freely. They lit their chulhas and prepared their favorite foods from meager rations that were available now. However, mass meal feeding was the norm. They felt grateful that the authorities had given permission for them to use the neighboring Lenigan Island for the sacred cremation rites of the Hindus and as a burial ground for the Muslims. To the northwest of the island, a large slab of rock provided the ideal site, separated from the depot, far enough so that the rising smoke would blow away, and close enough to the water, which is a prerequisite. This was the first Shamshan Ghat in the land. Many an evening, they would see the smoke rising from funeral pyres of those who did not survive their quarantine. Perhaps the winds would carry their last remains back to the motherland.
After the couple of weeks of quarantine on Nelson Island, the 213 survivors of the Fateh al-Razak were brought to the mainland, to the harbor of Port of Spain.
Beyond the last stretch of water lay the sugarcane plantations.
Their arrival was viewed with great relief as saviors of the failing sugar industry that was beset with so much labor unrest. From the port, they were assigned to various plantations. They went on horse cart, on bullock cart. They made their journeys to the estates. The darkest areas on the map indicate the major plantations between 1845 and 1850. Diego Martin was one of the first areas where Indians were settled, and they were taken to barrack housing. More Indians were brought in the 1860s to work in the Woodbrook estate. They created a coolie settlement close to St. James. The traces and the pathways where they settled inherited the names whence they came from, the motherland. Naipaul Street owes its origin to the Nepalese who settled there. In time, Nepal became Naipaul. Names of major recruitment centers appeared on signposts in St. James. We see Mathura, Bengal, Lucknow, Delhi, indicating that conscription centers were set up in such far-flung areas in the motherland. However, it was in County Kerry that most Indians flowed. They labored to clear the shrub and undergrowth and prepare the soil for plantation. Today, it is a lush expanse of productive cane farmland. The Kerry River's presence in this essentially Indian area was a tremendous sustaining force. Coming from the rich Gangetic plains of India, they viewed her as a sustaining force, a means of transport, offerings, and worship. As the benefits of Indian labor became evident to the plantocracy, new areas to the east of Kerry were opened up. There was much virgin land to be cultivated. One such stretch lies south of Arima. Sugar grew well on the flatlands, and today Malabar is a silent testimony to the thousands of Malabarians who opened up the cocoa reed forests. The sugar industry began to recover, thanks to the dedicated efforts of the indentured workers. Indentureship was of a temporary nature. After a five-year term, workers were free to return to India. In fact, up to 1895, they were entitled to a free return passage, but the opportunity to continue to work in the plantation as paid workers and then to earn 10 acres of land in lieu of the passage was an option that had to be weighed. Even though conditions were hard in the barracks and the laborers continued to be poor, earning 25 cents per task, they had a choice. Many had children born in this land. those who had returned had seen unfavorable conditions in India and returned to Trinidad. They returned with a sense of homecoming, often well attired and resplendent in their traditional jewelry. A growing sense of identity and cohabitation had developed within the insular community, and a sense of feel for the land born out of dedication and hard work. And of course, the incentive to own land. These were the factors that made hundreds decide to stay. In 1871, there were 27,425 Indians in Trinidad. This freedom of choice to stay or to return was the beginning of the Indian settlements. Bahari village on the Toka Road just outside of Sangli Grandi is where workers from Bahari village in India settled. There were settlements in Karatal, Rosilak, and Faizabad in the Oropooch Lagoon. Faizabad was named after Faizabad in Uttar Pradesh, a major source of agricultural enterprise. There are a few remnants of the old barrack housing. Constructed in 1845, in Laramane we found Hasina Ramjohn, 78 years old. She was born in Trinidad. I asked her what she remembered of the early days.
My father-in-law and my mother-in-law come from India. And he had a son, and one son, and I married to him. Please, I start to work from 10 cents. When I started to work from 10 cents, well, the money started to raise. Then it go up to 15 cents. The money started to go up more and more and more.
The labor and effort to produce far outweighed the meager earnings. The Indian cane farmer continued to struggle. He moved into vegetable, cocoa, and rice farming. Families were large and involved their children from a very young age into their agricultural lifestyle, tending to their precious cattle, to sowing, harvesting, and marketing their crops. This was the support system of the Indian family. Through all these hard times, there was a factor that ennobled every act. It gave light and strength and comfort. For had it not sustained them over the perilous journey from India to Trinidad? Had it not comforted them in the darkest hour in the ship hold? Had it not given them hope as they stepped off the boat in Trinidad? Had it not removed the drudgery of labor when they worked sweating under the harsh tropical sun, blackened by the soot of burnt cane? The sound of the sank, the sound of the azan, the chime of the church bell, had lifted their spirits, soaring towards the clouds, where there is no pain, no grief, no fear. The sounds that are so integrally linked with their respective religions had brought them to this point in history. In fact, on their arrival, the largest number of any one faith were those who were Hindu, then the Muslims, and then the Christians who had been converted by missionary work in India. Over the years, the work of the Canadian Presbyterian missionaries linked education with religion, and the number of Christians grew. The manifestations of this religious presence appeared in the mushrooming of domes. Domes that began to dot the countryside, rising heavenward, piercing the Caribbean sky. They were the silent symbols of a profound cultural connection with Hinduism, Islam, and Christianity. They soared above the burning cane, the dusty fields, and poverty. Each one a celebration of life. Trinidad and Tobago has had a remarkable religious growth. Today, the presence of the interreligious organization is a testimony of the fraternity that exists among the many religions practiced in this land. The Indians over the last 150 years have contributed in no small measure to this aspect of national life.
The other sustaining factors were their rich cultural traditions. When the day's labor in the cane fields was done, these humble folk, driven by a strong cultural force, gathered in the barracks. The haunting strains of the songs and legends of the motherland could be heard.
Ganga Jamuna Saraswati Abaso Pave Bariba. Hamajani Hamajani Kab se hoy be Raja Rani Rani हम जाने अब से हो
the thrill and excitement of the East Indian night wedding, when the Bharatiyans arrived on a Saturday night and were kept up being entertained by dances based on the legends of Raja Harishchandar and Sarvaneer. We were lucky to find a group in Rupchand Serju and his troupe.
Pranam Rani. ये कि हम लोग चल करके और फकीर बाबा के राजपाल सौंप करके हम लोग काशी के चलिए.
अच्छा राजा जी.
देखिए फकीर बाबा,
हाँ हाँ,
आप रात गद्दी पर बैठिए.
हाँ,
अब बैठ करके राज करो. हम लोग काशीपुरी के जाते हैं.
ओह, सो यू गेट मी द किंगडम.
जी हाँ.
अच्छा
बैठिए.
वो एक दिन दो दिन टू लॉन्ग है.
आए गंगा जमुना गोदावरी सिंधु सरस्वती संग सकल तीरथ काही बसती जारी कथा प्रसंग रानी सरवर नीर के ले चल मत कर नारी देर जहाँ जैसे राम राखे वही लगावे गाते आई वही लगावे तेरे रानी मेरी जिसकी गोरख गंधा वही लगावे तेरे रानी मेरी वही लगावे तेरे रानी मेरी जिसके गोरख गंधा देख तो राम नाम के अरे देख तो राम नाम के सुमरन करके उन्हीं के गुण गावे वही मुक्ति हो जावे रानी मेरी वही मुक्ति हो जावे रानी चल गंगा के किनारे रानी मेरी वही मुक्ति मेरी अरे देख तो वही मुक्ति हो जावे रानी मेरी चलो गंगा के किनारे
रानी चलिए हम लोग काश के
अच्छा
वही मुक्ति हो जावेगी रानी वही मुक्ति हो जावेगी रानी चलो गंगा के किनारे हरे जगह चलो गंगा के
pulsating rhythm of drums and the manjira would carry into the night air. Traditional dances and the clap of the gatka or Indian stick fighting would attract young and old. The ladies would make merry away from prying eyes, especially on the lawa night when the bride and groom were preparing for the sacred marriage rites. And the tasa, that festive drum that announced all special occasions, would touch the heartthrob of the Indian person. In 1845, when the first indentured workers arrived in this land, they were poor peasant pioneers looking for opportunities to better their lot in life. They dressed in traditional style. Both men and women covered their heads, wore yards of cotton fabric draped around them, either as onis or dhotis, or turbans, and basic items of jewelry. Both men and women had pierced ears, and women wore elaborate nose rings. By the time the bonded period was over, they were able to afford the fineries they had dreamed of. All the folk jewelry in the past was of silver. I asked Mankumari Sundarbasi Pare to remember herself as a young bride.
When I married and when I'm going back, I can't describe how much a jewel they put on. Baju, Bak, Johnson, Vijayat, all kind of the whole Hananite team, so you're falling down.
On her forehead, the sirbandi and tikuli. On the nose, the besar or dangling chulani. On the ears, the flat talki or dangling chumka. On the neck, the solid hasuli, the chakapahi, and the thok. On the arm, the bera, churiya, and chur. On the waist, kamarpatti. On the ankles, the solid karha, or the more delicate one. The rustle of her skirt and the tinkle of her jewelry made music as she walked. However, as the wages were earned in gold, they were translated into jewelry, an investment that was carried on the person.
They usually had a gold chakapahi, and then the tauk with guguru in it. So the gold one is to stop on top of that.
The godana or tattoo is an ancient Indian tradition and full of meaning.
Well, when the man comes, he says bahuriya. Bahuriya means the daughter-in-law or the daughter. Godnani had a book. He had a book marked down what you want.
Patterns.
Then the old people say, well, Sita ke rasoi or Sita ke kulwari.
So what you have on this arm is the Sita ke kulwari, that
yes.
Is Sita's garden.
Yes.
And on this arm you
rasoi.
Have Sita ke rasoi. That is Sita's kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
There are certain motifs typical of Indian adornment, the bindi or tikka. Traditionally, it is the mark that announces the marital status of a woman. Nowadays, the boundaries have widened and it is quite acceptable to see unmarried women wearing every hue and design of bindis, color coordinated with their outfits. As we leave the images of the costumes of the past, the image of the Indian woman with her head covered with pride and humility is still a fine symbol of Indianness in contemporary Trinidad and Tobago. The Indian personality anywhere in the diaspora has developed certain traits based on the rich inheritance. The Indian is strongly family-oriented and family-dependent. there is a great respect for elders woven into the tradition. Indians are cautious with spending. They value investments in land and the education of children. There is an intimacy with nature, especially in the Hindu tradition, where all living things are seen as infused with divinity. Isha Vasyam Idam Sarvam. Therefore, nature plays a conspicuous role in worship. I'll explain. The Indian civilization was essentially agrarian, linked with the land. The Indian looked upon the earth as mother, the giver. In Hindu worship, ritualistically placing a sample of earth at the Vedi or altar is significant. The offerings made at the altar are from nature's bounties. Water is seen not only as a physical purifier, but as the cleanser of the five senses. The betel nut and leaf are symbols of tenacity. The mango tree, the giver of nourishment, medicine, and fuel, is respected as an auspicious symbol of prosperity. The bamboo, springing branches from every knot, is symbolic of the Hindu concept of rebirth. One soul, many lifespans. The banana, a fruit bearer, a symbol of fertility and prosperity. Its arched leaves spreading in all directions, as does the universe, from the central core of divine presence. Flowers are a symbol of the joys and beauties of life. Rice has many meanings.
And so it is that one grain of this offered to the Lord and Master. Just as when you make one step towards the Lord, He makes 100 steps towards you. When you offer one grain of this rice, His blessings offer upon you 100%.
And the tilak, which is a sacred mark.
The tilak signifies the presence of the devatas and devis upon the body.
The simplicity of these offerings is in direct contrast to the profundity of the act of offering. For each offering has acquired a concentrated, vital, spiritual energy, creating an intuitive bond between God and the performer. The Indians always knew they were dependent on nature or prakriti. There is a harmony and balance in nature. It is with reverence that the Indian sees this balance, giving and taking from the land in the cycle of life and death. The potter or kumhar, who has played a very vital role in the fabric of the Indian community, creating his works for worship and utility. Since antiquity, his creations, pressed and molded by hand, have carried the fingerprints of history. In Trinidad and Tobago, we go back to 150 years ago, when the first indentured workers arrived on the boat. Among them were gifted potters, or kumhars. They discovered that there was an abundance of good clay in the Karani area, in the vicinity of Carson Field. In the old days, they would sit squatting, spinning the wheel with a handle connected to a stone slab on a ball bearing. This was the potter's wheel. The momentum of his spinning motion and the deft handling of the clay would shape the pot. The Indian's close connection with the earth, Mother Earth, is explained in the words of the great poet Kabir as he asked the quizzical question, Mati kahe kumharaso, tu kahe rundhe mohe, ek din aisa aavega ki main rundhunga tohe. The earth said to the potter, why do you need and shape and control me so? A day will surely come when I will receive you unto my lap. The pottery industry has grown in Trinidad and Tobago, and creative designs have added a new dimension to the traditional handicraft. The attractive peach brown of the terracotta clay adds charm as you pass along the main road of Chase Village in central Trinidad. Every year there are one or two new designs that enter the market. Yet it is in the making of diyas, diya houses, havankuns, shivlingams, and kalsas, all used in the Hindu puja or worship, that the potter has proved a vital link with tradition over the past 150 years. Of these, the kalash or kalsa is of special significance. Simply and quickly made, it conveys a profound spiritual message about the whole of creation. Let me tell you what the kalash signifies. It is present in every Hindu home, at every puja. Centrally placed, it is present when the bride-to-be is purified before she is ready to take her marriage vows. It is present when the groom is received by his father-in-law to be purified before he sits at the marriage altar with his bride, to listen to the chanting of the pandit as he explains the obligations and duties each has toward the other. Even the potter who sits to give thanks for the blessings of his humble abode and his gift of pottery places the kalsa central to his puja. The kalash is filled with symbolism. At the root of the kalsa is Brahma, the creator. The body of the pot is Aditi, the mother of the universe. Within the pot is the space that has ever been even before the material world was created and is therefore Sat or the truth. When the water is poured into the pot, it is Varun, symbolic of the Ganges. The neck of the kalsa is symbolic of Rudradev or Shiva, steadfast in meditation. The mouth of the kalsa is Narayan or Vishnu, through whose grace all life is sustained. At the top is Lakshmi, giver of knowledge and true discrimination. So within the clay pot kalash, so humbly molded by the potter, is a powerful message. The five elements are present: earth, water, fire, air, ether or space. The Hindu trinity of Brahma, the creator, Vishnu, the preserver, and Mahesh, the destroyer. One of the vibrant features of the Indian civilization is that over its past 5,000 years of existence, making it one of the oldest in the world, it has repeatedly been challenged by foreign invasion, but has absorbed and assimilated the invaders' culture, emerging richer and more tolerant each time. The Muslim connection with India began around the 2nd century AD. Their elaborate costumes and traditions in food, dress, language, architecture and festivals were completely absorbed in time. So when in 1845 the first Muslim forefathers came from India to Trinidad and Tobago, they naturally sought to maintain their tradition. One aspect of this tradition is the festival of Hussein or Muharram. I visited the home of Noble Bisnath in St. James to capture the ambience of an imambara where an exquisite tajia is being constructed for Hussein. Barred from the sun and the general public eye, craftsmen are at work creating wondrous structures. Jewel-like, they stand imposing, majestic. The dedicated workers paste and cut and measure under the gentle guidance of Noble, a master craftsman in the field.
My own imagination. I belong for that. I don't really look. I look back at books and pictures to see that what I think about it. I don't see it in the book. But in Islam, we try to keep the same shape of the domes. That's how I try to keep it. One style, Islamic finish. Well, the early days was easy. It was fast learning. But in those days, the whole thing used to make out of bamboo and roseau, no cardboard. Styrotechs come in since we have that. It's much easier than cardboard and sheets. In the old days, it take about 3 months to build a real dress. Mm-hmm. And now it's much simpler now, with cardboard and the type of material we have to get in. We don't get paper like before in the old times.
This project must be completed by the end of May. So they meet each night after the day's work is done, spending 5 hours of camaraderie. Muharram is the first month of the Muslim calendar. Over a 10-day period, Muslims mourn the martyrdom of Imam Hussein, the Prophet Muhammad's grandson. During the last 10 days of construction, the craftsmen will live in the imambara shed with the tajia or tazia. This is a time of total abstinence and personal purification.
to make themselves worthy to work on and carry the thazia in procession in the second week of June.
Well, we do indulge with no meat, no alcohol, we don't sleep with any female, no female allowed near you.
An interesting fact is that even though the thazias are constructed throughout the Muslim world, and the skills in Trinidad originally came from India, the artistry in this country has reached a special excellence, perhaps the epitome of thazia building. The fine details that embellish the body of the thazia are a subject to explore in itself. Delicate paper cutouts, each one handcrafted, will adorn the finished thazia. Outside can be heard the heating and testing of the tasa drums. There is a factory of tasa production within the family yard. The skins and drums are housed in their own special area. Nobles' children, friends and relatives look forward to the season when they can get together and beat the tasa hands, specially prescribed for the festival of Husay. This is the Husay beat, intricate and vibrant. Tasa drum is played in the north, south, east and west of India. However, it has undergone modifications here in Trinidad and Tobago. The lead and fule drums in India are shallower and produce a more metallic sound. The bass is also proportionately smaller. Over the past 150 years in Trinidad, the drums have grown in size and the clay pot body of the tasa has become deeper. The bass has assumed the boom and bass quality that is part of the sound of this land. Let's find out how these special drums are made. Mahadeo Golcharan, the master potter, is kept busy with orders all year round. He shapes the body of the tasa on his wheel. After it has dried and been fired, he prepares the skins that have been previously stretched and dried in the sun. The hair is shaved with a cutting edge of rough sand and is rubbed on the skin with the rim of a glass bottle. The circumference of the pot is then measured on the skin. This will be trimmed to size. The skin is soaked in water to make it flexible and ready for placing on the drum. A twine is threaded around the edge. It acts like a drawstring, tightening the skin around the clay pot. A skin cut in a spiral provides the long threads that will be used to sew the larger skin in place. The weaving and pulling has a twofold effect. It tightens the skin and creates an attractive pattern. The handle is also made of twisted skin. The drum is complete, and the maker is the drummer. The tasa base is created out of a log that has been hollowed, leaving a certain thickness on the rim. This drum is old, almost half a century old. The masala or concoction that is pasted on the skin has slipped into the inner side. It is this masala that gives the bass drum its boom, its resonance, and its full sound. The masala is made of coal tar, castor oil, soft candle, among other ingredients. The role of the tasa side is vital to the Indian community. It heralds the Husay procession. It heralds the sacred and festive Hindu celebrations. At the wedding home, it is honored as the symbol of primordial sound, the sound of the universe, Vani or Vak. The mother, with her head covered, makes offerings and places the auspicious vermilion powder on the drum. She then receives the offerings she has made in her jholi, and the money is taken by the drummer. After this act of worship, the tasa leads the procession for the matikor ceremony, the beginning of a Hindu wedding. The ladies make merry to the rhythm of the tasa. Today, the tasa side is a must at all cultural events, in Trinidad and Tobago. David Rudder, in his song Hussein, celebrated the drum.
Oh, what a sight on the night of the day. It was the night of the day.
Peter Minshall has paid tribute to this magical drum in his portrayal of Masquerade.
Wonderful bridges between our multi-ethnic cultures have been built through this drum. And our children continue to keep the tasa alive.
There are so many traditional skills that our Indian forefathers brought to this land 150 years ago. In my search for skilled craftspeople connected with these skills, I found Sudesa Budu in Ramaytres, Pinal. Colorful paintings in distinctly Indian themes adorn the walls. His home was a flurry of activity. His family prepared to decorate with dainty paper cutouts. I gather your grandparents came and then they returned. Do you remember the early days when you were involved in this activity in your family? What was it like?
Our parents are not here. They just left them here and they go back to India. But they leave their tradition, whatever they knew, they learn it to their children. And from their children, they learn their children, and it continue with the in the family. I get interested in me, not early age, it's about 30 years back, then I get interested, because I always leave it to the parents to continue this work.
And what are the various techniques by which you cut? Because some of the designs are very complicated.
I cut with scissors, sometimes I have plentiful paper to cut. I use a punch. I put it down on a piece of hardwood. I design what I cut, and I start cutting out that piece.
The handicraft of paper cutting has developed a new dimension in Trinidad and Tobago based on initiative and resourcefulness. In the motherland, there was an abundance of fresh flowers, and the Indian traditional method of decorating was always with flowers and foliage. On arrival in Trinidad, the early forebearers realized that they had to find a substitute, as fresh flowers were scarce. Paper was the answer. Initially, any paper would do, but when light, airy, colorful kite paper became abundant, it gave a new dimension to this art. Four or more sheets were folded together to speed up production. Cutting was freehand. The maro, or wedding altar, is also decorated with these paper creations. Some real flower maros are built in Trinidad. However, paper maros are the norm. Sudesa and his family showed just how easy the process is. The paper, plastic, and sponge combine to decorate the wedding car. The dome structure for the hood, called the crown, and the decorative plate for the front of the car are distinctly Trinidadian creations. The journey of 150 years in the art of paper cutting. The epic Ramayana has always been a source of comfort and inspiration to the Hindus of Trinidad and Tobago. I visited the Shivalaya of Pandit Krishna Maharaj, the Dharmacharya of the Sanatan Dharma Mahasabha, to get a true Trinidadian perspective on this 3,000-year-old faith that came to this land 150 years ago.
When our forefathers came from India, brought with them the Ramayana, the Holy Ramayana. And that book is to read under the mango trees because it was difficult then, under with flambeau lights. In that, they knew brother relationship, Ram, Lakshman, Satyugan, father and son, beauty between brothers, and like Sita and Ram, ideal husband, ideal wife. And that reminds, and the pujas up till now kept us alive.
The Ramlila, or the enactment of Rama's life, performed over an 11-day period, is an elaborate form of folk theatre that brings this epic to the whole nation. Though there were Ramlilas enacted in many parts of the country, the Dau village Ramlila is about 113 years old, the oldest in the country. We seldom see what happens behind the scenes. Come and join me. A great deal of effort goes into the preparation. Vivid, eye-catching colors are chosen for garments. Each generation, new players are thrown into the arena. As the players are made up to look the part, they reminisce on the Ramlilas of the past, when they were but children. There was that exciting scene of Sita Mata begging Lord Rama to capture the golden deer.
Hey, Alex, man. Oh. I am going to capture the airport today. And if he raptures in the sky, I will slay him. Please stay here and protect the city. Not jamming.
Though the Lakshman Rekha was laid down as the line of protection, she crossed it out of compassion for a poor holy man who was in fact a ferocious ten-headed Ravana. He captured her and fled into the sky on his white horse chariot to Lanka or Ceylon. Her cries for help reached the Jatayu bird, who battled, losing his life in the fight. The costumes they wear today are clever innovations. Previously, they were made of cardboard, sequins, and braids. Today, they utilize the sophisticated art of copper plates, beautifully studded and sculpted into crowns, the breastplates, the armbands, and the handbands. All copper creations. Hanuman uses a rubber mask, but his big pot belly and the red sindhur which he rubs on gives him the ruddy traditional look of the boisterous, playful Hanuman. The building of the tall 40-foot Ravana, made from bamboo, paper and glue, takes place alongside. Since the aim of the epic Ramayana is to establish the conquest of good over evil, the fight between the noble Rama and the evil Ravana ensues. Ravana falls with the arrow that flies from Rama's bow. Everyone knows that all is well. All is well in the world, as good has prevailed over evil. A topic that confuses a lot of people is that of the various murtis, or gods and goddesses, in Hindu worship.
Idol worship is ideal worship. And the murti is a place like students go to school. So they worship Saraswati Mata with a veena in her hand for knowledge, wisdom, broad intellect and retention of memory. And here you have murti of Shankar Bhagwan. When you worship him, Bala Bhuti Vidya Dehuhi, what is strength, Bhuti intellect and Vidya is knowledge. Now you have the murti of Ganesh Bhagwan. Ganesh is called Vigheneshwar, relief of all difficulties. And at the time of Lakshmi Puja, when you celebrate Diwali, you worship Goddess Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth and prosperity, health and happiness, and long life. So each murti worship gave us blessings.
Acharya Prabuddhananda Saraswati, a sannyasi, one on the path of self-realization, explained.
Even Rama, Krishna, etc., all of them are only a creation of this culture. The culture itself is not initiated by Rama. It is not initiated by Krishna. It is not initiated by any person at a given time. Because every person is a product of this culture. Achyutaha means the imperishable. Anantaha means the unlimited. Govindaha means the truth behind the senses. Gopalaha is the very support of the senses. Krishnaha means the most attractive, meaning the happiness. because what attracts everyone is Krishna. Ramaha means the locus of the whole universe. Vedic culture accepts worshipping God in any form. Hindus are not naive to believe that there are many gods. It is the Westerners really who are naive enough to believe that we believe many gods. When you salute a flag, you are not saluting a piece of cloth, but you are saluting only the nation, the symbolized, the ideal.
So, God is seen in the form, the saguna, and the formless, the nirguna. Since Hinduism sees man's existence on earth as spiritually evolutionary, God as seen in the form is a stepping stone to the true, formless, all-pervasive God. And there is the Jap Mala, which keeps a personal count of the repetition of the Lord's name. And the repetition of the name is the repetition of the image, which is the repetition of the concept of the divine. Cut off from India for the greater part of 150 years, the Indo-Trinidadians' contact with India was largely through the Indian films. For many years, the films were not subtitled in English. But when successive generations of Indo-Trinidadians began to lose the Hindi language and the Indian film began to boom and capture the world audience, subtitles appeared on the silver screen. Yet language or no language, in Trinidad, there was a cultural affinity with things Indian, and our talented people began to mimic the golden voices of Lata Mangeshkar and Mohammed Rafi, often not understanding the meaning of the songs. The classical films helped in a real way in the preservation of the religious and cultural life of Indians. The more glamorous films distanced succeeding generations from the real India because they were based on fantasies. In Trinidad, from infancy, the girls see themselves in the image of the great movie stars. Feminine and glamorous, they love to dress up in all the Indian finery. Dance schools have mushroomed throughout the country, and some wonderfully creative dance sequences based on Indian films have emerged in this land. This has given a fillip to the indigenous dance choreography. So many Trinidadians of Indian origin say, I don't know what it is, but there is a pull, a stirring of their heartstrings that draws them to the music and the dance. The modern Indian films, often mimicking the West, that are churned out of Bollywood, as the prolific Bombay film industry is called, bear very little relevance to the Indo-Trinidadian of today and are hardly inspiring. Hum Aapke Hain Kaun has reassuringly reversed this trend. Yatra turns to cuisine and the concept of curry. So much a part of the Indian presence in Trinidad and Tobago, I visited the home of the Parrys, located in the picturesque Maracas Valley, where I sought out Mrs. Shakuntala Parry, who is one of the finest cooks in the country. She extended a warm traditional welcome. Atithi Devo Bhava, the belief that to honor a guest is to honor God. Indian tradition at its finest. Curry is a concept. The word curry is said to be derived from the word thari, which means gravy, during the British Raj in India. So curry is a thari, and a thari is made from a masala base. Masala refers to any mixture of spices. We went into Mrs. Parry's kitchen, where her seal and lorha, traditional Indian grinding implements, were waiting. A full-bodied masala is made of 2 spoons of dhania or coriander, 1 of zeera or cumin, 1 of methi or fenugreek, 1 of rye, mustard seed, 1 of kalonji, onion seed, and 1 of sauf or aniseed. A masala can be wet or dry. By dry roasting the same mixture, the color darkens and a rich, full-bodied flavor of the spices is achieved.
The word masala is thought to have come from the Hindi word masalna, to rub between two surfaces. By adding water, the dry masala becomes a paste. Then there is the wet masala, made from certain vegetables like onion, garlic, pepper, bandhania, or shadow beni. The mixture breaks down on the sill until a smooth, flavorful paste is formed. It is the addition of saffron-colored haldi or hardi, turmeric, that transforms the mixture into a curry paste. The method of cooking curry is also unique to the Indian cuisine. When oil or ghee, clarified butter, is heated and a few cumin seeds are allowed to crackle and pop, and the curry paste is added to the pot, this method is called chonkna or chonke in Trinidad. Once the mixture is well singed and fried on a medium heat, vegetables, meat, poultry, seafood, whatever, can be added and given a quick stirring to incorporate the masala, then covered and allowed to steam in the pot to aid in the process of cooking. In my search for key factors that have influenced the Indian presence of Trinidad and Tobago, I found rice to be of special significance. It is an ancient and staple food in the Indian diet throughout the diaspora, rich in carbohydrates, proteins, and essential vitamins. It provides inexpensive nourishment. Simply boiled or spiced or cooked with meat and vegetables, as in a pilau, a dish that originated from India. In the 1800s, when the bondage period was over, those who remained in Trinidad chose to go into rice cultivation. Whole families worked in the fields with their feet steeped in water, heated by the sun. They endured much hardship, gathering the mutta in their clasp. They sliced it with a hasua or grass knife. So many Trinidadians are convinced that this time of struggle was a time of toughening the spirit and responsible for their present-day success. The Indian, coming from an agricultural background, makes offerings of the finest produce of the land at his altar. Rice is also a symbol of prosperity and fertility. From a single germinated grain will grow a stem laden with scores of rice grains. Rice is roasted and puffed at the lawa time during an Indian wedding and offered to the sacred fire, seen as the holy witness. In offering this rice, it is hoped that the boon of prosperity and fertility will be returned to the giver. Rice is also used to decorate. The vibrant rangoli is a work of art created from rice grains, symbolizing mangalaya, prosperity and goodwill, especially at the entrance of a home. I visited the home of Angela and Bharat Gelai in Penal, a family involved in rice farming, everybody lending a helping hand. Dhan, or unhusked rice, is fanned to allow the chaff to blow out. When the rice is nice and clean, it is collected in bags, which are carried out to the mill for dehusking. The day's work done, a quiet calm descends upon this rustic home. Bharat's mother cleans the rice in a soup in a rhythmic, relaxed and traditional manner. The milkman prepares to milk the cow. The lovely frothy milk, fresh from the cow, will combine perfectly in the preparation of meetha bhat or sweet rice or kheer. Angela puts on her pot, stirring the rich creamy mixture of milk, rice and sugar, a dotting of luscious raisins and a sprinkling of spice. Here is a dish fit for the gods. Yesterday was a significant day, Indian Arrival Day, the culmination of 150 years of Indian presence in Trinidad and Tobago. On this grand occasion, the National Council of Indian Culture was honored by the presence of Their Excellencies, the President, Mr. Noor Hassan Ali, President of Trinidad and Tobago, and Mrs. Hassan Ali, and His Excellency, the President of India, Sri Shankaldayal Sharma, and Mrs. Sharma. This grand parade was the vision of Chandradath Singh, Chairman of the 150th celebrations and the parade. The parade began with the arrival of the Fateh al-Razak or Fateh al-Razak,
the pioneers riding atop the waves, sailing toward the western horizon to Trinidad and Tobago. This was the Jahaji time, the bonding time, where many friendships were made. The purpose of the arrival in this land was to plant sugar cane. And so, symbolically carrying bunches of cane, came the people to parade on this momentous occasion. As thousands of people watched, came a symbolic float connecting the past through the present to the future. Princess Carmini in the Garden of Eyrie. Her mother symbolized the early indentured worker when they arrived in this land, struggled and toiled, and built a future for succeeding generations. Princess Carmini is the blossoming and flowering of such a child of the future. And these are our children, growing in independent Trinidad and Tobago, frolicking and dancing, wearing the dress of their ancestors, traditional dress from faraway India, the land of inspiration on this grand occasion. Thousands of children were there, proudly in their school uniforms, holding banners, celebrating those who are significant in their community. There was much symbolism. The man carrying the Ganga Jal from the Ganges River from India to Trinidad and Tobago, linking our ancestry. Indian tradition was evident in various symbols. The Hindu wedding was on parade. 150 villages were involved in this grand parade. They all combined their efforts and talents. Here we see the sugarcane plantation, the reason for which our Indian forefathers came to this land. The Holy Ramayana was portrayed larger than life, which has been a source of inspiration for our people then and now. The float of Siudat Sadhu, showing one man's effort and willpower in building a temple in the sea. Dancing atop the Himalaya Club, showing that over 150 years we have kept cultural practices alive. These are but a glimpse of what we saw yesterday. There was a magic in the air for all who experienced it. Welcome to Yatra. Tonight is the last in the 25-part series of Yatra. I'm Anita Chandradath Singh. As a final salute, I visualize the theme song composed by Chandradath, my husband, in honor of the 150th anniversary of Indian arrival in this land, entitled This Is Our Song. It is sung by the St. Augustine Girls Alumni Choir and friends. The three calls of the Hindu, Muslim, and Christian faiths are sung by Niharika Naidu. Journey with me on this final yatra as we travel through the landscape of this beautiful land with our beautiful people. This is our song.
This is all.
has been my great pleasure to create this series, searching into the subtleties and intricacies that make up the Indian presence in Trinidad and Tobago. And so, the song says, this is our song on a journey just begun. May you continue to have a happy yatra in the journey of your lives. I'm Anita Chandradath Singh, saying goodbye.